टेक्नोलॉजी सोलन सर हैज डन हिज पीएचडी फ्रॉम मौलाना आजाद नेशनल इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी भोपाल इन 2008 एंड पोस्ट डॉक्टरल फेलोशिप फ्रॉम टेल अवीव यूनिवर्सिटी एट टेल अवीव इजराइल. He has been honored with many notable awards and fellowships in his entire career in bioinformatics. His research interests include functional genomics, molecular evolution and phylogeny, systems biology, data mining and immunoinformatics. Sir, I on behalf of all the students of Department of Biotechnology at GLA University express my utmost gratitude to you to have you with us and to acknowledge us on bioinformatics. Sir, please.
Thank you,
okay. Surbhi. Thank you, Surbhi, for the beautiful introduction. And first of all, thank you, Anuja, for inviting me for a webinar. We know it's a difficult situation for all of us, the COVID-19 pandemic. But still, through the technology, we can interact with each other. We can share our knowledge with each other. So today here I am to present you a small webinar on the topic bioinformatics. Basically, I will start with introduction to bioinformatics. And then I will switch over to a special case study of Alzheimer's disease. That's a neurological disorder and that is creating problem at global level. So my request is to please mute your mics, everybody. You can send your queries in the chat and later on we can have the question answer session also. Now I'm going to share my screen so I can show you my PPTs and I can start the talk. So Anuja, is it visible, my PPT?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, so students, thank you for inviting me. I would like to start now with the term bioinformatics. You know, bioinformatics is something that happened like 2 decades back or more than a 2 decade. Actually, what happened, you know, biology, we call that mother of all the sciences sometimes. So marriage happened between biology and computer science. And after this marriage, a beautiful child was born. And that child was named as bioinformatics. So basically, it's a combination of biology plus informatics. Because the data that we want to analyze is always biological in nature. And we want to apply techniques on it to deal with it. So this is how the bioinformatics started. Now this is the topic of my talk today, like from a new beginning to application-based problems and with a special case study on Alzheimer's disease. So presently I am working in JP University, as you already know. So when we talk about the bioinformatics, you know, we want to deal it in a systems way. It's not like a single entity we want to deal with, like DNA, RNA, proteins, signaling networks, clinicians data, environment biologist data. So the data that is available in component form. But now we want to deal it in a systems way. We want to analyze it as a whole. So this is how this bioinformatics came into scenario. Later on, several other branches also came that I will also discuss. But if you want to have a complete understanding of the biological system, then bioinformatics can definitely help you. If you look, bioinformatics is highly interdisciplinary in nature because it involves several fields. If you want to be expert in bioinformatics, you should be good in biology, you should be good in computations also. If you are good in physics, that is also very good. If you are good in chemistry, that is another domain. If you are good in mathematics or stats, another domain. So there are several domains where bioinformatics is playing an important role, because biology, that is the source of interesting problems and data. Then you have chemistry, you have physics, mathematics, statistics, information technology. And then health professionals and medical practitioners or doctors or clinicians data can also be involved in it. So the data can be of varied nature, but to apply computational techniques, mathematical techniques or statistical techniques, we need the combination of these techniques to solve the problems in biology. So if you want to define it in a very simple terms, Bioinformatics is the creation and development of advanced information and computational techniques for solving problems in biology. Just a moment. Yeah. Now, when we talk about bioinformatics, there are some specific objectives of it. So, like, you want to generate the data on everyday basis. At global level, thousands or sometimes millions of experiments are going on every day, and we are generating huge amount of data. Now, how we are going to manage that data? How we are going to analyze that data? How we are going to disseminate information generated from that data? How we are going to store that data? Nowadays, you heard the term big data. Now, big data is something that is having multiple dimensions. There are huge amount of volumes. The velocity of data is high. So these terms are actually making data very complex. To analyze that data, we need specific techniques. And, you know, informatics is growing day by day. So bioinformatics can help in this. So we can organize the data. We can store it in databases or data warehouses. And we can develop tools also to analyze this data. So these are the three major objectives of bioinformatics. How we are going to deal with data in a fruitful way to generate biologically meaningful information. Now, just to tell you a little growth of bioinformatics. You know, 70s when DNA sequencing started, at the same time, alignment with Smith-Waterman or other dynamic programming algorithms like Needleman and Woolf was also there. So, parallel development of biology and computer science was happening. Now, next thing is 80s. When sequence databases were developed, like NCBI was there from National Institute of Health, USA, that is situated in Bethesda, Maryland, USA. So EMBL, European Molecular Biology Laboratory, GenBank from NCBI, and DDBJ, DNA Data Bank from Japan. These three primary repositories came in the scenario. Accordingly, other techniques of alignment like FASTA and computer science techniques like linked list, hashing, and other data structures were also implemented into the biological data. When we come to the 90s, when automatic DNA sequencing came, then we got the most popular tool in the domain of bioinformatics and biotechnology till date, and that is BLAST, Basic Local Alignment Search Tool, which was based upon the neighborhood words, the probabilities of the system that we were dealing with. And additionally, in 90s, internet was also there. World Wide Web came into the scenario. So World Wide Web came, internet came. And after that, when huge amount of data was generated, people were looking at the omics approach. It came like genomics, proteomics, transcriptomics, metabolomics, and many other omics. More than 60 omics terms have been coined, you know, in last 20 years. More than 60 omics terms. So, you know, when Human Genome Project came, first draft came in 2001. Then in 2003, the final draft with 99.99% accuracy came. So what happened? Many groups were working on the genome annotations. 1995, a group of scientists led by Craig Venter at the Institute of Genomic Research, and they published the first living organism's genome, and that living organism was Haemophilus influenzae. Viral genome came, then Mycobacterium genome came, Saccharomyces cerevisiae genome came, human mitochondrial genome came, and this is how the genomics started. Once genomic data was available, we got the proteomic data. Proteomic data was there, we got the metabolomes, metabolomic data. Transcriptomes came later on, transcriptomic data. But the data was generated. If you look at the growth of the databases, like in 70s, there were 20 protein sequences, even in the protein data bank. Very few structures were there. 80s, it came into thousands. And then we got millions of sequences. So this was like data explosion. And how we are going to generate information from this data. That was really important. So when genomic era came, there comes the role of this specific tool that we call the bioinformatics. So, bioinformatics gave us the system for annotation of biological data. Okay, so we got this data and analysis technology, and that tool was the bioinformatics. Now, when Venter's group was moving towards the annotation, other groups were also there. There were so many conflicts also. If you can go through Human Genome Project history carefully, the British Prime Minister and the US President, they came onto the common platform to declare that we are announcing the Human Genome Project. Otherwise, there were lots of conflicts and people were saying that either UK is going to get the credit or USA. One paper was published in Science Journal, one was in Nature. So there was lots of conflicts. Then these two big leaders of the world came onto the common platform to declare that we are making this a joint venture for the sake of humanity. So this is how Human Genome Project came into the scenario. Now comes the term annotation. Bioinformatics is a major tool for annotation. Annotation is something like you want to make sense out of a linear sequence, or from simple structure you want to annotate in a big way. So annotation, you can identify the primary structure, secondary structure, tertiary structure, even quaternary structure. You can identify the motifs. You can identify specific patterns for regulatory elements. All these things you can identify with the help of annotations. So bioinformatics is the major tool for annotating. In this webinar, I can see students are from BSc and MSc. So either you are doing biotechnology, you are doing microbiology, you are generating lots of data, or you are having your own data, or you can take data from databases. But if you want to analyze it, you need technology, and bioinformatics is the best technology for that. Now, a little bit about the Human Genome Project. If you see this particular slide, I put it purposely. You see this person going on to the moon, and here the footprints are like DNA. And Francis Collins, who was the chairman of this international project from National Institute of Health, USA, he compared this event with other two events, and one was splitting of the atom and another one was going on to the moon. And he said sequencing human genome is the third comparable event. So you can see the significance of this particular project. And we can see the data explosion started just after Human Genome Project came. 2001 onwards, this biotechnology, bioinformatics domains grows rapidly at all the level. When we talk about the properties or pros of anything, there are always damages or cons of anything. Human Genome Project also has some side effects, like being human, we have to follow some ethics. So there are some ethical, legal, and social implications associated with Human Genome Project. And you see this particular cartoon, the boss is knowing your genome. Once your genome is available on the public's domains, like, you know, today we are dealing with social sites, a lot of things are everything, every data of us is almost available on the social sites. Or if not, they can hack it anytime. So once you are sequencing your genome is available to your family members. It can be hacked by your boss, or maybe boss is recruiting you while you are having the genome. So after reading your genome, your boss is saying that you are lazy, you are unproductive, and frankly, you have got a lousy genome. So this kind of scenario are possible when we talk about the genome's side effects. Now, there are so many open problems in bioinformatics, like we have to find out the genome of all of the organisms. We have to identify and annotate all the genes, their protein products. Then we have to compute the structures for all the proteins, compare DNA and protein sequences for similarity by using alignment techniques, compare the families of DNA and protein sequences. But we are optimistic because biology is finite, around 30,000 genes. Now you can see papers are representing 19 or 21,000 genes are there, and around 1,000 protein superfamilies are there. And computing is keeping improving day by day. Data is generated at a huge amount. So we are optimistic that whatever problems we have in biology, we are going to solve with the help of computer science. Now, when we took bioinformatics like as a career, or you want to apply bioinformatics in your domain, either it's biotechnology, geology, botany, chemistry, physics, microbiology, or anything associated with biodomains. So what exactly you are doing? When you are a bioinformatician, you design new algorithms and programs to analyze the data. You develop new databases for the representation of the data. You build graphical user interface, the websites or visualization tools. And nowadays, you know, we are working on apps also. So we can develop small apps for small tasks for computations. Then you are playing a very important role in the society. You are always working in close association with biologists or computer scientists also. And you are applying this biological data analysis for generating functional, structural, and evolutionary information to the scientific community. And there are many more aspects associated with bioinformatics. Now, if you look at some of the job prospects in bioinformatics, either doing your BSc, MSc, PhD, higher study options are there in India as well as in abroad. In abroad, there are several options in bioinformatics, and nowadays people are focusing more on biomedical science also because of these kind of situations. So you can go for the method development and storage like database, data warehouse, then retrieval and analysis of data through data mining techniques. You can work on sequence analysis and structural bioinformatics. You can, if you are interested in plant sciences, you can go with the agri bioinformatics. You can go for the pharmacogenomics. It's a relatively new term. Like pharmacy, you are dealing with the drugs. But when you are dealing with the drugs with respect to specific genomes, then you call it as pharmacogenomics. Like pharmacology was there for drug science. But pharmacogenomics is associated with the genome because every drug behaves differently for a particular genome. Then you have systems biology. You want to study biological systems as a whole, like the whole cell, or the whole organ, or the whole body. Then synthetic biology. People are trying to synthesize artificial blood. More than 75% components of the real blood have been synthesized already. Some part are remaining, and I hope within 10-20 years, they are going to make the synthetic blood. There was one project from European Union that was Smart Hand project. So they made a smart hand through synthetic biology approach, and that smart hand was connected to the brain. So whatever you think, you can move your fingers, you can catch the objects and all these things you can do. Means that smart hand was artificial hand, but that was connected to your brain. So these are the applications of synthetic biology, but associated with systems biology or bioinformatics. Recently, we are working with the various disease, either it's cancer, diabetes, cardiovascular disease, Alzheimer's disease, other neurological problems like Parkinson's, schizophrenia, and all these diseases, we are dealing with IT and medical science coordination. So we are calling it as biomedical informatics nowadays. So that is also like a branch taken out from bioinformatics. So biomedical science or clinical trials, you can capture the data electronically. You can manage the data through database management systems or data warehouses. You can generate your own decision support systems, and you can have your clinical decision support systems also, where clinicians can provide inputs and you can easily grab the information for the patients or a particular disease. So basically, here the role of artificial intelligence and machine learning is also there. If you are involving machine learning and artificial intelligence, then definitely biomedical, bioinformatics, AI, and ML. These four combinations are making wonders for the humanities in coming future. And you can see that. Now, when we talk about the bioinformatics, now thing is that how this bioinformatics can help us in the analysis of heterogeneous data that is being generated all over the world. And finally, how we can generate biologically meaningful information for the scientific community as well as for our society. So I am going to take a case study now. It will be on Alzheimer's disease. That is my research domain also. So you can work on any domain. As a student, you can work on any disease. You can work on plants, I told you. You can work on genome, proteome, transcriptome, anything of your interest. But my only purpose is, you should be sincere enough to whatever you want to do. Then only you will get the good results or good outcome. Either it's your final year project, either you have minor project, do work sincerely on a specific problem, and I am sure by sincerity you can pay your tribute to your society by doing some wonderful things. So coming to my this special topic of Alzheimer's disease, you know, this is a progressive and irreversible neurological disorder. We know elder people are having more frequency of Alzheimer's, but it can happen in younger people also. There are some effects, genetic, some environmental, lifestyle disease also. You know, diabetes, cardiovascular disease, all these are the lifestyle diseases nowadays. And we people are more on the technology side. There are pros and cons of everything. Technology is very good, but it should be used in a positive way. If it is used in a negative way, it can harm our body even or our society. This particular disease, you can see around 50 million people have some form of dementia, and Alzheimer's disease is the most common form of dementia. And it is expected that by 2050, more than 150 million people will have dementia worldwide. So it's a serious problem. And in India also, it is growing rapidly. But thing is that we are more worried towards other things and we are not much worried about this. But this is like a neurological nightmare that is happening in the background. So we should be careful about it. Now, if you see this particular picture, this dotted lines outside, this is the healthy brain size. And inside is the shrunken brain with Alzheimer's disease. And here you can see the dying neurons with tangles and amyloid plaques. So basically, amyloid precursor protein that is degraded and making the amyloid plaques. And then we have that inside the neurons, we have the tangles, that is the neurofibrillary tangles. And that is because of the tau protein. Tubulin binding proteins are there. So microtubule associated protein tau, and that tau clamps are formed that are making the healthy neurons sick. Later on, these neurons are dying because their communication channel is blocked. So this is the major problem in this disease. You can compare these two images. The left one is the healthy brain and the right one is the Alzheimer's disease brain. The shrunken size and lots of vacuoles even inside the brain is creating the problem. And this is how it is affecting the cerebral cortex, the hippocampus, and other parts of the brain. If you look at the global impact of dementia or Alzheimer's, 2018, 50 million people, 2030, 82 million, and by 2050, 152 million, and US dollar, 1 trillion for the caregivers, for the caring of patients, for the medication, for the facilities. This much of money has to be spent. So you can see it's lots of money involved. We have to be careful to save the economy as well as our people. If you look at the causes, there are genetic causes, there are environmental causes. In genetics, there are some specific genes, amyloid precursor protein, PSEN1, PSEN2, and the Down syndrome. But if you look at the environmental factor, history of head trauma, you might have gone through some accident, your head, some part is damaged, smoking, diabetes, reduced physical or cognitive activity, circulatory risk factors associated with cholesterol or cardiovascular disease, and increasing age. These are some of the factors which are creating problem. If you look at the symptoms, we have the memory loss, we are forgetting words, problem in speaking, reading and writing, disorientation to time and space, we have misplacing things, drastic personality change, and difficulty in performing daily routine works. And you know, in the later stage of Alzheimer's, even patient forgot to eat the food. They don't know that you have to take the spoon, take the food and take it to your mouth. They forgot this thing also in the severe cases. That's why I included the stages here. So mild cognitive impairment is the first stage, then mild AD, moderate AD, moderately severe AD, and the last stage is severe. And I told you it's a progressive, irreversible process. Now there is no drug available, but symptomatic relief drugs are available. So treatment options, if you want to look at, this cholinesterase inhibitors are there. So this acetylcholinesterase enzyme is there. So cholinesterase inhibitor drugs are available in the market with the name donepezil, rivastigmine, and galantamine. Then there is another N-methyl-D-aspartate, that is NMDA receptor antagonist, that is with the name of Namenda. Recently, another combination drug, memantine plus donepezil combination therapy with the name of Namjaric, that has come into the market. There are many drugs that are in the clinical trials, and some hypotheses are being failed, like amyloid beta hypothesis, tau hypothesis. So hypotheses are also there, but exact cause and its progression is still unknown. People are working on it at global level. These are the molecular characteristics that I told you, the neurofibrillary tangles and amyloid beta plaques. You see this picture clearly. These are the plaques, the brown ones, and these blue ones are the tau protein clamps inside the neurons, and these are making neurons dead. Now, I would like to discuss a little bit about the work from my lab, like how bioinformatics and systems biology approaches for Alzheimer's disease can be helping us in analyzing the data. So we have applied lots of bioinformatics to analyze the biological data. And here I will show you just a few examples of the data that we have used in our studies. Just a moment, I don't know, system is getting slow. Okay, so here in this slide you can see GSK3-beta and CDK5, two enzymes we are working on currently. So we are applying structural bioinformatics, SNPs, genomics, and other techniques. So major enzymes that we are working on, what we are doing, we are looking at the CamBase and other databases. We are selecting some molecules, doing the docking with these enzymes to inhibit their active sites, and then performing the simulations for the complex at 100 nanosecond levels. So molecular dynamic simulations are being performed. And you see in this study, we have published and we find out four compounds. So we have selected four compounds from the Zinc database, which are showing good affinity, good binding affinity with this GSK3-beta. And then after performing molecular dynamic simulations, you can see these RMSD and RMSF images, 100 nanosecond, sometimes 60 nanosecond images. So after performing all this, we are proposing some molecules. In another study, what we did, we worked on the acetylcholine esterase inhibitors. We identified some compounds like gallic acid, caffeine, ascorbic acid, and bigacetate. Donepezil was the control. And another compound was quercetin. It's a herbal compound. So these compounds we selected, we docked them, we performed simulation, and besides that, we performed in vitro testing also. So we performed this AOETBR and DAPI in vitro assays were performed, and our results were very much positive. This work was also published in a good journal, Current Alzheimer's Research. So this is how the combination of experimental science as well as bioinformatics are playing important role for dealing with the biological problems. So in vitro neurotoxicity assay test was performed, and then we identified that quercetin was working very good, caffeine was also good. So if you feel that somebody is having Alzheimer's disease or problem, if you give him or her coffee dose every day, twice or thrice, it can help in at least sustaining the symptoms. Now, there is no definitive evidence to support the prevention of AD, but definitely by changing our lifestyle and by changing prevention to other diseases like cardiovascular, hypertension, diabetes, and smoking and drinking, we can save part of it. Now, persons who are involved in intellectual activities like reading, playing board games, completing crossword puzzles, playing musical instrument, or regular social interaction, then they are having less chances of Alzheimer's disease. Similarly, if you are maintaining a healthy Japanese or Mediterranean diet, then you have a reduced risk of Alzheimer's disease. So these are some of the factors which could be controlled easily in our daily life. So AD is what we should care about. It's nothing, but we should care about, because no drug is available to cure it, but symptomatic relief drugs are available. So we can care for the elder ones. We can care for the patients. It can be in our family also. It can be in neighbor's family or anywhere. These are some of the databases that have been developed from my lab, like ABCD. We published this in recently 3 Biotech Journal. Then ADGAP is there, that is pending. And there are many other databases. My domain is another, like cancer. I am also working on DNA repair mechanisms and cancers also. But here I took just one case study, like Alzheimer's disease, because people are not much aware about it. So symbol, hope, and take home message for Alzheimer's disease. You see this purple color. This is the symbol for the Alzheimer's Association. And this gives us hope also how to deal with this particular disease. This is my university. You can see the beautiful pictures, view of my campus. Anuja was here with us for 2 years. She did M.Tech Computational Biology from my university. I taught her for almost 2 years. She was a sincere student. And that's it. Thank you very much. I would be happy to take your queries. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for the wonderful session. Hopefully, yes. Students ko koi doubt hai, you can ask any question.
You can even chat me, so I can see that and I can answer from there, or you can ask me directly.
Any doubt, students?
So, students are from BSc and MSc, Anuja?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Hello, sir.
Sir, actually, we had a very nice information. I didn't know much about Alzheimer's. I read, but yes, I am reading it from a different angle or knowing it.
Okay.
That it is one of the autoimmune disorder.
Like yeah, autoimmune can also be there actually, but exact cause is still not known. But my plan was to give Alzheimer's as a case study, but plan was to introduce students some bioinformatics background also. So,
sir, this is one of the disease where they say that maybe autoimmune nature, but the pathogen I am working for this last 30 years is a Mycobacterium paratuberculosis.
Okay.
Is causing basically this chronic enteritis in the livestock, domestic livestock.
Mm-hmm.
So this bacteria, after entering through M cells from intestine, goes to lymph nodes. There it gets multiplied in macrophages, and then it spreads all over the body.
Mm-hmm.
And then it also comes out through intestine, of course, since intestine is the basic site for the multiplication, and also through milk and other secretion.
Mm-hmm.
This is how it is passing on to the next generation. So there are papers now, sir, and they are linking this pathogen with this Alzheimer's, even Parkinson's.
Okay. Yes, sir. There are many studies where actually gut microbiota has been studied for Alzheimer's as well as other neurological disorders. So people are working on gut microbiota.
Actually, in animals, this gut microbiota is more important, because that was source of giving them immunity.
Yes.
Because they were grazing in the wild. So they were having a lot of good... because they require to digest this lignin and this hard this fibrous material.
Mm-hmm.
these fungi, these unicellular parasites, then many of these bacteria, they all work. And this is how this is degraded. Otherwise, they cannot digest without this microbiota. So, human has a huge source of this microbiota as compared to a simple stomach animals. So, that I have also seen that it has changed over the years. There is a change in this microbiota because those friendly pathogens have been slowly replaced by these more pathogenic because they share common antigens. So they have pushed them out. They were simpler and they have pushed them out. And they're not, they are not available to animal because grazing land has shrunken like anything. Animals are giving just bhusa or tied to one place.